Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Loving Self group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Releasing My Pain presentation, Jesus explains that once the facade is released, pain is easy to identify and experience, and he outlines the methods to release pain and gives general notes and guidelines for the release of pain through an emotional experience with God's help. Recorded on the 8th of June 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
All right, my prep hasn't been that good this morning, so we'll see how we go this morning. Our discussion today, it's still like 3 minutes to go. Better wait for just in case. Is everyone here already?
Everyone important,
did you say? Everyone's important. Richie hasn't been here, so everyone is here. Okay, well, I can get started then. 3 minute head start, you never know what I can do with that. Okay, so the discussion today is about releasing my pain. This is a place where most of you are going to get in the future at some point. So it's good to know a little bit about it beforehand, but not too much, otherwise you might not do it. No, it's okay. Well, what we've got to have done first, let's have a look at the things we have to have done before we can do this. So releasing the pain discussion really depends upon the fact that you've done these things, okay? So what I must have done. Okay, first thing. What do you reckon it is? Any ideas? Just yell it out if you think you are. No, I can't. Oh, didn't hear any of it. You might have said it, but... You must have developed some faith. Without faith, it's impossible for you to even contemplate dealing with your pain. And without faith, you can't have gone through this process. So if you find when by the time you get to this process, you think you're at this process, and you still feel scared of the whole thing, then you haven't done what's above it. Simple as that. Because once you've done what's above it, you're not frightened of it anymore. All right? Very, very simple. And faith is what draws you. Remember, in this process, we learnt last night, in this process of deconstructing the facade, you learn faith. Right, so if by the time you've gone through that and you get to this and you still can't handle this, there's still not faith. Faith hasn't been developed yet. Faith is the key thing that's going to carry you through everything, and you're going to need to develop it without fail. It's an essential quality. So you must have developed some faith. If you don't develop faith, no chance of you actually progressing, really. Okay. The second thing you must have done is accept your facade. I still notice many of you asking questions about your pain when you're actually asking questions about your pain associated with not getting your addictions met. Still haven't deconstructed the facade, still even haven't accepted it. Still believe you can skip over it, still believe you can get away with not having compassion for it, still believe that you can have an awakening to sin without even knowing how you sinned. And that's not possible. So this is a part of this is step number one in your awakening to sin. If you don't perform step number one in awakening to sin, you're never going to get to step number two, awakening to sin. So very important that you've done that already. Before you can release pain, you'll need to have done that. Three, you have to have deconstructed your facade. In other words, you've gone through this process of getting out of denial and into awareness. You're now aware of, certainly most of your physical, emotional, and spiritual addictions. You've also deconstructed them. You've also stopped yourself from, you've found the emotional reason that drives their validation and drives your justification for you to get the addiction met. And you've released the emotional reason for that. So that emotional reason no longer exists inside of you. So you're not always justifying to yourself and others meeting your own addictions. Right? You'll have found by that stage that most of your anger and rage has disappeared. So by this stage, a lot of your anger and rage has disappeared. You're no longer focused on just getting addictions met. You're not addicted to comfort and satisfaction anymore. You're okay. By this stage, you've developed a feeling that you're okay with feeling emotion now. You're okay with being overwhelmed by any emotion. You need to be in that state that you're okay with being overwhelmed by emotion. And that all is developed during the deconstruction of your facade. Deconstruction of all of the techniques that you use in your facade. Now, by that stage, you've had an awakening to sin. By that stage, you've now developed some humility. By that stage, you're used to experiencing emotion. By that stage, you're very focused on truth, aren't you? So those four key tools, you're very aware of their need and necessity of development. So you already have an aspiration to develop them further. And you love them by this stage. You love those tools. Now, how I know most of you are not there yet is because when I start talking truth to most of you, it's like, get away from me. So this is an indication that you're not there yet, because a person who's gone through their deconstruction of their facade loves the truth. They love working out things that are relating to their pain. They love to hear about these things. It's a part of their discovery of truth about themselves, and they love that. They even, and by this stage, you also have a fair amount of compassion for yourself, right? Where you actually love yourself. You love yourself enough to experience your emotions, because that's a part of loving yourself. Being willing to experience all of your emotions is actually a part of loving oneself. So that would need to have been done. Now, remember, the point too of doing all of that was to actually get to this, wasn't it? And to actually release that. So that's the fourth thing you would need to have done as well, is released terror. So you'd have to have released terror. And remember, the other point of the facade was to desensitize yourself to pain. So what, as a part of this, you would have to have sensitized yourself to pain. In other words, you can feel the pain inside of you. And you can still feel that there's fears suppressing it, but you're at least feeling the pain inside of you. And the fears suppressing it are not the terror that you had. The terror you had is dealt with. That's gone. You've gone through a process of dealing with terror. And that process is going to look pretty bad to you. It's going to look pretty bad to others if everybody sees you doing it as well. And that would need to have been done. Now, can any of you honestly say all that's been done? Not really, right? Okay, so that means that you're not at the point of releasing your pain. And that's, you can see that you're not, because if you examine releasing pain, there's some primary states that you're in that place, and we'll talk about that a little bit in a minute. So that's what I must have done. Pretty clear? Yeah. So you could say, The majority of us still have a little faith. We have a little faith, not none. Otherwise, you probably wouldn't even be here at all, right? You've also been willing to start to look at yourself, right? But for most of you, that's not a compassionate process yet, right? You're not yet have compassion for yourself in that place. You're still attacking yourself and abusing yourself. And also, there's a temptation in that place to abuse other people when they expose things in yourself as well. And that still frequently happens for the majority. So that means that the majority of us are there, right? And then there's that deconstruction process. And this is a beautiful process that God's designed as a part of your awakening to sin, so that by the time you come out of that process, you've awakened. It's like somebody's got you, you know, in the morning, you know, when you're just real tired and you're just laying there and you're just about sleep, somebody comes along and is shaking you awake. what? And then there's that initial confusion, and then, oh yes, I'm awake, I'm here now. And that's really what you feel. It's like that emotionally. You start feeling like you're awake now. And before you were asleep or half dead is what you is what you feel, right? So the deconstruction process is very key. Pivotal process for you to go through, because that deconstruction process, it helps you develop many tools that you're going to need. It helps you finish up having a strong faith in the process, in God's process. You also, during this phase, has usually started to receive some God's love, because God approves of each thing that you do in harmony with love. And you feel that after a while, once you have it longer. So you're starting to feel a little bit of God's love. That builds some faith as well. So your faith is now quite strong. Your humility is now quite strong. You are quite able to examine yourself. You don't need anybody else telling you much about yourself at all at this point. You can see things very clearly. You know that it's an emotional process. You're not resisting your emotional process. And so things are pretty open, so pretty humble. You're accepting all of your feelings. Very, very important place. And then you remember the whole point of doing that was to get to touch your terror and be able to feel your pain. And by this stage, you're really starting, you've gone through your terror. And now you're pretty open to the pain and the false beliefs that are above it. Does that make sense? And these are still fears, but they're not terrors anymore. They're fears, and because they are only fears and not terrors, they're pretty easy to feel in comparison with terror. So you've already gone through terror, so now feeling your fears is nowhere near as difficult as it was before. Does that make sense? You know what you've really done? All of that process has done something to you. You've done this. Become a child again. But not just a child anymore, but a child with awareness, a child with capacity to understand. So you're childlike without being childish. Does that make sense? You now have a capacity to understand. If you think about it, when you were a child, you were sensitive to pain. You were close to your terror, if not have feeling it a lot. There was very little facade, and so therefore very little to accept. So by the time you've done this, you've really gotten back to that point. You've chosen to undo the sin of parents, society, and your own. You've now had an awakening to sin. And those things are important to do, and they must be done before you can really release pain. Now, we might be able to get through to pain in certain times before then, but it's not going to be consistent. You're always going to be terrified. You're never going to feel it fully. You're probably going to have to revisit a lot of the pain you did feel in the past if you got to it without feeling your terror and so forth. The majority of you have believed yourself to be there, feeling pain, when actually you've yet to even do this, let alone this. This is the area that you're going to find the most difficult. Remember the reason why you're going to find it the most difficult? Because it's a time when you've got little faith with a lot of stuff to deal with. And the motivation to deal with it is low. So we're resisting dealing with it generally. Once you get to here, now the motivation to deal with pain is very high. You see the benefit of it, you know the benefit of it, you've experienced the benefit of releasing pain associated with your own creations, and now you're able to allow yourself to go through the rest of the pain related to your own and society and parents' creations without too much resistance. Up here, remember, there was all the false beliefs that we're engaging and justifying that we had to release. Down here, it's going to be the cause of those beliefs going, releasing. So we've become a child again. Wonderful. Wonderful. You'll feel, by that stage, you'll feel like a different person already. But the law of attraction hasn't changed markedly except for one primary area, and that is God's laws are not having to constantly remind you of your sin, because you know what your sin is. So God's laws don't have to do it to you anymore. And you'll know that. You can feel that. You're aware of the pain that's the result of the sin that you've engaged and others have engaged. And you're aware of that. God's laws, you don't need God's laws to show you it anymore. Whereas up here you did, because you're in denial and you're in your addictions. You needed God's laws to show you those things. If we go, Graham.
I was just wondering, if I become a child again, like when I was first a child, what's then to stop all those emotional injuries entering me again?
Well, you're also, remember I said you become childlike while you still got cognizance as an adult. And because you've now gone through the deconstruction and awakening to sin, you're not going to probably engage the sins again. Because you've had to experience the pain of what it felt like to engage them and have to deal with that.
So that's why you said I'm an aware child.
Correct. I'm an aware child. I'm able to go no to sin. Whereas when I was a little child, I was unable to do that because I didn't have cognizance or awareness. But now that I'm this adult child, if you like, I've now got cognizance and awareness, and therefore I know how to say no to sin.
Thanks, that makes sense. Yep. Yeah.
Peter, thanks. And then Ivana after that.
Is it in the deconstruction phase that we break all our family ties with our parents and all of that? Is that when that really comes to the fore?
Not fully, but you're aware of how the family created pain. See, most of you at the moment are still justifying your parents' and society's behaviour towards yourself, right? You have a lack of love of self, you know, you've not got compassion for yourself. And so what you do is you finish up justifying to yourself how your parents have treated you and how society's treated you. And you still, in a fashion, really agree with that treatment. Right now, many of you are in that state where you sort of agree with that treatment. And you can see you agree because those of you who have children often treat your own children the same way as your own parents taught you. So that indicates the agreement. Right? By this stage, you no longer agree, but you still haven't released all the pain associated with it. You're aware of the pain and that it exists. Does that make sense? Yeah, Ivana?
I was just wondering, so when we come to that place, are we going to actually feel similar to how we did when we were children?
You're going to feel oppressed. Like, you're going to feel, in the world that we live in, it's very hard to live. You're going to be very sensitive to the pain that people cause you. You're going to be very sensitive to any pain that you cause somebody else, and so forth. And you're also sensitive to your old pain that you've stored inside of yourself.
Yeah.
You're sensitive to that, and you just let yourself, and this is what we'll talk about in a minute, what releasing the pain looks like, but you're so sensitive that when you notice it's there, it just comes out of you. There's no need to even select it or to work it out.
Yeah. And like with the positive sort of things, would we also like sort of express ourselves more like we used to when we were children?
Yes, you'll also, and we'll talk about over the following 2 days, the last 2 days, how you'll also in this place start to see bits of your real self poking through now. Yeah. So you know how with your facade, you've basically hidden your real self with a curtain in front of it, right? And you're really just projecting an image of yourself in front of that curtain to the world. And once you get to through this stage, you no longer desire to project an image of yourself to the world because you've gotten rid of the desire to do so, because all of the desire to sin has been released from you, or a lot of it, the desire to sin, not all of it, because the desire to sin comes from the avoidance of pain, not pain itself. Does that make sense? So the desire to sin has come from really the justification for the addictions. It causes a desire to sin.
I'm getting a bit confused, but...
The pain is just pain.
Yep.
And it doesn't need to cause you to sin.
Oh, like you were saying the other day.
Like we were saying last night.
Two different people can be abused or something in the same way, but choose different...
Correct.
Yep.
So okay. By this stage, you're seeing that the choices you made here, you've released the reasons why you wanted to choose that. Does that make sense? And as a result of that, you're sort of like a child now who has no desire to hurt anybody.
Okay, and that's the place where you're just willing to feel.
You're willing to feel other people's hurt of you and your own hurt that's inside of yourself and your own hurt of yourself, because that's where lack of love of self is, but you're not willing to hurt someone else in order to avoid it anymore.
Yeah.
Okay. Up here, you were willing to do that. Down here, you're not willing to do that.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Thank you.
Your will has been developed now in the opposite direction than the will had been developed in the reversal issue. You see, if you look at how the will has been developed in your diagram, and most of you, I notice, have a printout of that diagram, you'll see the associated will development of that particular diagram. So here you see the will being used negatively in each case to create the next layer. Well, what we've done is we've now used our will to deconstruct each layer, which has meant engaging a lot of very positive will-based choices that we've made. And as we've done that, we've learnt a lot of things, and we've learnt the destructiveness of sin. So it's highly unlikely we'll want to engage it. And when we do, if we ever do, because we still feel some pains occasionally, and we unfortunately sin occasionally, what happens is we're gutted by it. We feel terrible about it in that place. And it's not a self-punishment. It's just that we feel terrible because we're so sensitive to each pain that results from a sin we've created. Because we're sensitive to it now, before we weren't. So we're like this childlike, sensitive individual who now has awareness about sin, rather than not knowing, not understanding, not knowing what the causes of pain are. Wonderful place to be, actually. Yeah. Yeah. If we go to Amber, thanks.
In the process of releasing the pain and deconstructing your facade,
Don't mix up the processes, Amber. Releasing the pain we haven't even begun to talk about yet.
Okay.
Yep. But go on.
With the part of deconstructing the facade, is there a point where you just become incredibly exhausted in this process?
No.
Okay.
Because everything you release causes less exhaustion. You're exhausted now because you're fighting the process. Everything is less exhausting. You feel more energetic, less exhausted. There are moments when you hit a certain thing that you feel the resistance build up, and as soon as the resistance build up, your exhaustion will build up again. It's the resistance to the process that causes your exhaustion. Does that make sense?
And is it mainly the resistance to the terror that will...
Well, that obviously has a large effect on your exhaustion, the terror. So once that's gone, now the only thing that can make you exhausted is your resistance to your fears. That's the only thing that will make you exhausted after that.
And how does the terror and the fear look different? So once you've released all that terror...
We'll talk about that later.
Okay, thank you.
Yep. Okay. Can I move forward? Because there's probably more to discuss, and then we can ask more questions about it. So everyone's all right up to that point? What's happened? Okay. Wonderful place to be. Many of you are totally frightened of that place because you're so sensitive. We're worried about being sensitive again, right? really worried about the fact that we're feeling our pain, other people's pain now, and most people in that place can't handle it very long because they still have terror about feeling pain. But once you get to this point, you've not got the terror about feeling pain anymore, so you can handle it. You can actually feel your own pain and other people's pain and not get really distressed about it. You know that it just needs to be felt, needs to be released, you see. Very, very good process. Now, because we've done that, we have now entered this state, this sort of childlike state, if you like, that would normally happen to a child under a circumstance where the parent is not influencing the child. What would normally happen is when the child chose to do something, or the child had done something done to it that was out of harmony with love, the child would instantly feel it. Does that make sense? Now, because of that, and because we now have deconstructed everything above this layer here, that's so everything from the terror upwards has now been deconstructed, the only thing left is really our false beliefs about love and our false beliefs about what is true, and so they are the fears, and the pain that those fears control. They're the only things that are left. And as a result, we can become aware of them and see what they are quite easily. And once we release the pain, once we go through the release of pain, which we'll talk about as a process in a minute, once we go through the release of pain, the false beliefs and the false definitions of love, in other words, everything that we thought was true, will change. All right? So a lot of what you think is true right now will completely change as a result of that process. But it won't change until then, right? Because you need to release pain for it to change. So ask yourself, how does a child process emotion? Pretty obvious, isn't it? As a child, remember the child learning to walk? He experiments. He falls flat on his face. He doesn't then store it all up. He cries. Now that he's cried, the emotional pain is gone. What does he do next? He gets up and experiments again. Really simple process, isn't it? Experiments, when he fails, falls flat on his face, he hurts, he cries, finishes crying, finishes hurting, gets up, experiments again with it. And it's a seamless process of learning in that place where we're not afraid to take actions, we're not afraid to experiment, we're not afraid to make mistakes. That's the place we're in. So how the child processes emotion is how you need to be able to process emotion in order to do this, with one exception, and that is, there's false beliefs and false definitions of love that also need to be accessed. But you are an adult now with awareness, so you can see the false beliefs and you can see the false definitions of love, and you feel them in your body. And every time your body starts to get tired, exhausted, or it starts to hurt somewhere, you know, I've got a fear. I've got a fear related to that particular area that's shutting me down in that particular way. And all I need to do is find this fear and release it, and then I'll be in the pain. I'll be able to feel the grief associated with this fear, that this fear is covering and keeping under control. And I'll be able to then feel that grief and fear. So the process, so if we look at the process for a moment of what release is, it's really quite simple. It's feel the fear of each, better write that so you can see that, each untruth or lack of love. In other words, down here, in this area here, we've got false beliefs that are untruths that we believe. And here we've got definitions of love which are false. So that's where lack of love has influenced us to believe that certain things that lack love are love. So we have a warped, the world's view of love, very much the opposite oftentimes, most of the time, of God's view of love. And we start to see, feel the world's view of love as being wrong. So we see it as a lack of love, not we don't call it love anymore. And for the sake of another word, let's call it, that's what it is. And both of those things are fears, false expectations appearing real. So at the moment, before we process them, they appear real to us, and then we identify them, we release the actual fear itself as an emotion. It's got to be as an emotion. We release the fear as an emotion. Once we release the fear as an emotion, the underlying emotional pain, grief, pops up. And you'll find it will just pop up without any control. Don't need to control it. Pain automatically. Is felt. Don't even need to try. It was the fear keeping the pain down. Once you deal with the fear, pain just comes out. So, you know, for each individual thing, it might take a few weeks to become aware of it. It might take another few weeks for you to actually go through the processing of the fear of that particular thing. And once you've processed the fear, and that's going to require shaking and feeling quite stressed and whatever, and the more you're resistive to that process, the more your physical ailments will increase for a while. And then you go over the hump, if you like, and now as soon as you're over the hump and you've released the fear, bang, pain just start crying, and away you go, and how long it takes, and you finish when it finishes. Dave?
So with the analogy yesterday with the key, then that fear there is the key to that room of
pain.
Yep.
Correct.
Yep, thank you.
That's it, yep. So you feel the key in a lock, you know, once you feel the fear, doors open, I'm in the pain. And you don't have to, you know, think about it or work out what it is, you just feel it. And sometimes you won't know what it is because some of it's related to times when you weren't even cognizant, you know, when it happened when you were little. As a child, and other times you'll know what it is because you did it to yourself. You took an action. You did something that created a sin that created your pain. And you'll be very aware of those times, of what that's about. All right. Yep. If we come down to Laura, and then across to Paige next to her.
Why do your physical ailments increase in that process? Like,
yeah, it's very simple reason why is we're going along like what we consider to be normal. We're not aware. When our fear kicks in, we try to resist our fear,
yeah.
Right? And it's the resistance of fear that creates our ailments.
Yeah.
Right? And they're all physical, can be physical ailments as well as emotional ones. But our physical ailments in particular are all created by the resistance to the actual pain itself. And that's all about the fear that we have. So it's a resistance to feeling the fear. Once we start feeling the fear, we usually are at the peak of when, you know, the worst point in terms of our physical feelings.
Yeah.
And then during that point, we start feeling our fear and we really let ourselves feel it. We've released enough fear and all of a sudden the pain will come out. So now your ailments, if this is a scale of ailments, physical ailments,
yeah,
where you don't notice them and so you're in denial of them, then the fear kicks in and now you're starting to notice them and usually you're trying to push them down, right? So this is where, you know, you're working against yourself.
Yeah.
But everyone does that until they get to the point where their desire is to feel that fear. Once the desire kicks in and you want to feel that fear, you feel it, and that releases the blockage to feeling the underlying pain and also releases, immediate releases, any problem, any energy block. So you see, pain in your body is all about energy blocks in your body.
Yeah.
You know, many of you are taking like supplements, vitamins, whatever. But the problem with that is often you're adding toxins to your body under those circumstances. Because what's really happening is your body is like this, this spirit body. Remember, it's your spirit body that governs the problems in your physical body. So if your spirit body is blocked in a certain area, so my spirit body at the moment is blocked in my throat, my shoulders, my eyes, and my bowel. Does that make sense? So any one of those areas, there's a blockage of the flow of emotion, a blockage of the flow of energy results. As a result, your physical body will experience pain in those particular areas. You follow? Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then as you deal with the fear associated with the particular problem, that will release. And once that releases, you'll feel the pain will immediately go away. Immediately go away. I'm talking about you go from thinking you're going to die for something sometimes to thinking, wow, that was I feel pretty good now. I've seen people, like, give an example. A person I know developed a thyroid problem, and their whole throat just swole up. She went to the hospital. They put her in surgery. They told her that the next day they'd have to do emergency surgery on her, and she'd have to then take thyroid medication for the rest of her life. She went home. She guessed that it was about the fact that she hadn't confessed to her husband her infidelities. She did that, and the very next day, her entire thing was gone. She went back to the hospital, because she had a booking, and they said they must have misdiagnosed her. Wow. All right, that's what happens. You resist until you surrender. All of a sudden, things change. Make sense, Laura?
Yeah. Thanks.
So many of you are freaked out when your body starts hurting, right? You are. Yeah. When my body starts hurting, I go, I must be getting closer. That's good. Paige.
Just following on from Laura's question, I was going to ask, is this exactly what's been happening to you in the last couple of weeks?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm getting closer and closer to some core emotional issues that I've been trying to get close to for quite some years, and it's really good. I know that I'm getting there. I know that after this group is done, I'll be pretty close, and if I give it another few more months working through my fears, I'm going to have an increase in pain probably till I deal with the fears associated with some of these issues. Once I deal with the fears, things will change quite strongly. Now, it might take longer than that. I don't know how long it'll take, because they're quite severe issues. They're issues that began as a part of our, their return process. And as a result, like, I had a bowel operation when I was two. I had a part of my bowel removed then. So I've always had problems right from that time. So I'm dealing with those issues now, the child, real child issues. And, yeah, so to me, I'm looking forward to that, because that means my worth will be very different afterwards. That means my body will feel really good afterwards. Yeah. So sometimes I look in the mirror and go, you don't look too bad, but gee, you feel terrible. You know? And I do sometimes feel really bad.
But you trust the process.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the fever and all those things, you just ride through it because you trust the process.
Yeah. The more you fear it, of course, the worse it gets. So, you know, I already fear it quite badly, otherwise I wouldn't have intense pain that I have. But if I feared it even worse, it would be even worse. You know what I mean? You relax with it. And because you've dealt with the underlying, the terror that was above it, you're not terrified of it anymore. You're not searching for medications and all those kind of things, you know? Yeah.
Cool, thanks.
Patty, if you just come forward.
Does that same kind of physical ailment feedback loop happen when we're in the top part of the diagram?
Certainly it does. Okay. Yeah, certainly. It happens everywhere in the entire process, certainly. But the problem is, for the majority of us, the higher it is in the process, the less sensitive we are to pain. So it usually requires more intense amounts of pain before we actually do anything about it. And also, the higher we are in the process, the more determined we are to use addictions to avoid pain. So we revert to our addictions as a result, whatever those addictions are. Whereas down here, we're not doing that. So you don't, you know, you're not reverting to addictions in order to avoid the pain. Yeah. If we go to Lani on this side, just straight to Lani, and Phoebe on this side.
It seems like without God and without real faith, this whole process is going to be impossible.
It's not impossible, but there are certain emotions that you will need to deal with that will be impossible without God. So it's not impossible to deal with a lot of your personal pain and so forth, because this is what a lot of spirits have to do anyway in this process. See, we haven't yet engaged the laws of repentance or forgiveness, have we, in this process? We need to talk about those later. But so it's the same process that spirits would need to engage to get to the sixth sphere, just they do it usually a lot slower. You know, it takes many years, if not centuries, for that to occur. So it's the same kind of process, but you won't be able to address all of your major sins, because remember we said right at the beginning that the major pain we have and the major sins we commit are all to do with our relationship with God. And of course, a person who doesn't involve God is not addressing those emotional issues. You follow? So of course, if we're not addressing those emotional issues, then obviously there'll be that pain left over. The pain of not addressing emotional issues associated with our beliefs about God.
And that becomes our, well, part of the engine.
That drives all of my behaviour. Mm. Yeah, so for a six-sphere spirit, the engine that drives their behaviour is their belief that they are a God, that they are a part of God, that they are a fragment of God, if you like, that they can create and do whatever they want, and not, they don't so much develop it. Even, and I'm talking about even ones who are Christian or non or Muslim or Jews or whoever did have a concept of God, if they don't develop emotionally this relationship with God, then they still don't have a relationship with God. And so they're still seeing themselves as an individual being without, and they don't have the relationship, so they haven't addressed their pains associated with God. Does that make sense? They've usually addressed some of them, though, because, you know, once you get to the sixth sphere, you're aware of this, you know, of how wonderful creation is. So you do have some concept that, well, somebody must have put all this system together, you know. But it is possible to be a atheist and still exist in the sixth sphere. Yep. Once you've worked through your own things, you've developed natural love to the pinnacle of natural love, and so it's possible to be there. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, now we're over at Phoebe.
Yeah, I just had a clarifying question from following on from Patty about the fear creating illness and then how you deal with that in the facade section. Using the example of your friend with the throat thing.
Mm-hmm.
So she hadn't dealt with any of the facade.
No, but she was suppressing the truth. Remember, the facade's about suppressing truth. So a lot of our illnesses do occur here because we're suppressing truth, for example. And in her case, she was actively suppressing truth, not wishing to speak of it. And as a result, she was aware of what she wasn't willing to speak of.
So her illness wasn't created by her pain?
No.
Ah, okay.
It's by her avoidance of telling the truth. So it's by her facade.
So that's why she was able to deal with it without having deconstructed anything?
Yeah, yep. Because there's still the underlying reasons why she was unfaithful that needed to be addressed that she hasn't addressed, actually.
Ah, I see, yeah.
Does that make sense?
Makes more sense.
She hasn't addressed those, but she has at least addressed telling the truth to her husband.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, thank you.
Mm. And if we go across to...
So it seems to me that you basically still do that process of feeling the fear of each untruth in the addiction facade phase as well, like you basically apply the same.
Yeah, but
thing.
It's a little different up here because you're actually engaging addictions as well that have to be deconstructed before you're going to see the fears associated with mm-hmm. each false belief that you have. So you have to actually get rid of the addiction too. You have to stop the addiction. If you don't stop the addiction, you won't do it. Simple as that.
But
whereas down here you have very little addictions. Down mm-hmm. here,
mm-hmm.
everything's just raw. And you're not engaging addiction to cover it over anymore.
Right. But we still have false beliefs and fear and things.
Of course. Like one of the false beliefs I talked to you about yesterday in deconstructing the facade is this false belief that I deserve to be able to do this to you.
That's right.
I'm allowed to do this to you because I want things from you and you should give it to me. So that's a false belief, isn't it? So there's still false beliefs up here, but there's addictions on top of them.
Right.
Okay. They drive these addictions, and you've got to remove the addiction before you'll probably see the false belief that you have, which is, I want to do this to you because of what it gives me.
Right.
Which is a very different thing than down here, because down here you're actually feeling the reason why you wanted to do these particular things as a covering of what the pain was. Right. Very different sort of a process.
Right.
So this is why many of you have got mixed up, you, where you think you're here when you're actually here.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, thank
you. Does that make sense? If we go to Sandra on this side, thanks.
I'm just wondering, with any pain that we now feel emotionally, like if something comes up, is that all just related to our facade pain? None of it is real pain?
Yeah, if you haven't accepted your facade yet, which is where we've said the majority of you are, then all the pain that's coming up for you is about not having accepted the facade or a part of the facade. It's very rare for you to be able to get down here because there's a whole heap of things you've got to do to get down here that you haven't done yet. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So it's got to be related to facade. Now, remember, was it Chris yesterday when you asked about, wasn't it? He's back there at the moment. But if remember, you asked about this emotion of hopelessness, for example, thinking it was a part of the pain. And I talked about how it could be a part of the addiction. See, and this is where most of us are. We want it to be a part of here, but it's actually oftentimes a part of here. We need to work our way through it, you see, that way, yeah.
So every fear that comes up is also related to facade, obviously, as well.
Well, fear can come up at any point, can it not? We can have fear that denial covers. We can have fear that all of our addictions cover, right? And then we can have fear that covers pain. So there's going to be fear at each point. You've got to get used to feeling fear, right? Yeah. Once you feel the terror, you'll be pretty used to feeling fear. It'll be easier to feel fear. And this is a beautiful thing about this process of deconstructing the facade, is that helps you develop humility to fear, which is what you're going to need for later. See, a person who's humble to fear doesn't act upon fear and hurt others when they're afraid. They don't do that. A person who's not humble to fear is willing to hurt others when they're afraid, willing to justify the hurt of others. So yeah, there's fear all the way through this process. Please don't assume that it's all just here or here. There's all the way through the process. There's fears. You're going to need to feel them. They all cover deeper feelings, some of which are completely just addictive beliefs. In fact, many of your fears protect the addictive belief. So back up here, if I've got a belief that I can hurt you, like, and I should be able to hurt you when I want to get what I want, then that's obviously an addiction, right? Driven by a fear of what? That I won't get anything I want if I don't hurt somebody, if I don't manipulate you somehow, if I don't blackmail you somehow or attack you somehow or do those things, I won't get what I want. So there's fears obviously covering that. Make sense? Yeah. Okay, well, so can you see the process now? The process is really quite simple at this point, isn't it? Because what we're doing is we've done all the things that block the process that's natural. So now we're down in this sort of natural, fairly natural process. The pain will be the most natural process of all, because once you've released the fear, the pain's just there and you feel it. And you don't block it, you don't shut it down. But you do have to, in this state, you're still focusing on getting rid of some fears that block each pain. And so it's because each pain created the fear. Each pain that you have creates a false belief. You see? The pain, so for example, if I was treated badly as a child, maybe I was never allowed to get what I want without getting belted as a child, let's say. Then I'm going to probably have a very strong pain associated with the use of my will, where I believe and I have a false belief that if I use my will as an adult, that the same will happen to me as happened as a child. And that is, I'm going to get punished and hurt if I engage my will out of harmony with society or family. So you can see the pain creates the false belief, And so I'm going to have to actually feel this fear of, you know, being hurt by family, being hurt by society. And once I feel that fear, I get to the underlying pain, which is when I was little, I got hurt by my family every time I engaged my will. And so I cry that out. And then not only the false belief, but the pain is also gone. And once that's gone, I'm now open, an open book. And if I long for God's truth on any matter about that subject, I'll get it and know it. But I must long for it. God's not going to give you a truth without you asking for it. And the way you ask is not with the intellect, but rather with the heart, your feelings. That's how you ask. So you've learnt that by now. You've learnt that everything is emotional. So let's make some notes about this process, shall we? It's a very natural process, particularly feeling the pain itself is quite natural. Let's make some notes about the process. One important note, the process is emotional. The process is emotional. It requires, though, using your intellect with some degree of logic and faith. But at the end of the day, unless you deal with the emotion, no change is going to happen. And that applies to the entire process, right from the beginning. Each thing that needs to be deconstructed, you've got to go through an intellectual awareness phase as a part of the deconstruction process and essentially the emotional phase. Many of you go through the intellectual phase and then think you've done. Nothing changes because there's no emotional phase that's been engaged. All right, so the process is emotional. But it has to address real emotion. Not facade emotion. And what I mean by facade emotions is emotions that you make out you have so that you can avoid your real emotion. And many of you do that. You go, oh, I'm just so thankful. I'm just so thankful. And I'm going, no, you're not thankful at all. What are you talking about? You feel scared to the hilt. How can you be thankful when you're so frightened? Yeah. You often want to portray an emotion that doesn't exist inside of you. Now, you're not going to get away with that with God's way. You're going to have to learn to feel the real emotion. So when you hear a truth and it makes you angry and you feel the anger and then you try to go, oh, that was a wonderful truth, that's a fake emotion. It's not real. It wasn't a wonderful truth for you in that moment. You feel angry about it. So just feel angry about it and let yourself feel the fear that that covers. Does that make sense? It's a very important part of the process. Tara. Sorry if we gave the mic down here. Sorry. Sorry, Nikki.
Can you feel grateful and thankful whilst processing an emotion? I've had that happen where I've been feeling something, but I'm feeling grateful and thankful.
You'll definitely feel it while processing emotion.
Yeah, okay.
But you certainly won't feel it before you have.
Yes, but at the same time as feeling, you can still, yeah.
Yeah, it's very unusual to be grateful for something that's terrified you. Yeah. For most people, if they're terrified by something, you just, I'm just terrified now. It'd be better to be truthful about it. And the same with God, be truthful about all these emotions. So the process is emotional, but it has to be the real emotion you're actually feeling, not the one you'd like to feel.
That gratitude is actually feeling grateful to God, isn't it? That you're seeing
or
the truth.
Could be others too. You might be grateful that your husband's in your life or whatever after you've processed emotion. But it's unlikely you'll do so when you're angry with men.
Oh, no, that's right.
Does that make sense? You've got to get rid of the anger with men and all the reasons why you're so angry with men and why you think you can boss them around and manipulate them and all those things before you'll actually feel real gratitude for your husband. Yeah. And any gratitude you feel before then is because he just does what you want.
Yeah.
Does that make sense? And that's not real gratitude. Sure. That's just you bossing him around and him doing what you want.
Yeah.
And you being happy that that's the case. In other words, you being happy that your addiction's met. That's not gratitude.
No.
Right. So it has to be real emotion. Yeah. Okay, so process is emotional. Now, that being the case, can you see the quality that's going to be needed is humility? Isn't it? That's going to be anything to do with our emotions is all about humility, being humble to the feelings. Very, very important. Now, we've talked about the importance of faith already. We've already developed that to a large degree in this other process here, but the quality of humility is essential now. We have developed it through this process, and now we're going to have to be really hot on it. To be humble. Always be humble to what I feel. Allow myself in. Particularly hard when you're feeling fear. So you've done terror, so that was great. You've learned a lot of humility while you deal with terror. But when you're dealing with the individual fears, it takes a bit out of you. You sort of feel initially you're not very humble to the fear. And remember that can cause physical pain. So that tells you you're not being humble to the fear. And then once you get humble to the fear, the pain will disappear. And that's told you now I'm humble to my fear. I'm feeling it. And then once you feel your fear and you're into the feeling of the pain, of course all of the symptoms will disappear, along with you feeling much better as a result afterwards. And also many of your false beliefs about that issue, all of them will probably disappear. So you're no longer addicted to holding on to a whole group of false beliefs. Does that make sense? Quality of humility, really, really important. You can see the next thing that's really important is to actually the way you handle fear. At times, you're going to be tempted to revert back to creating an addiction rather than just stay in your fear, stay in the feeling. So the way you handle fear, so I should probably put there, the way I handle fear needs to be a way where I accept it rather than just trying to push it down all the time, trying to reject it all the time in this place. All right? The more I reject my fear, remember, my fear of blocking my pain, so the more I reject my fear, the more slowly I will release pain. And the goal of this is to release it as fast as you're able, isn't it? To release it as fast as you can, because the more you release, the better you're going to feel. And the better everyone else around you will feel about you as well. Or they'll feel better things from you. You'll be more capable of love. Yep, so that's a really important part. I've also got, I've also got the importance of, remember your fears are your false beliefs and your issues regarding love and truth, your false beliefs about love and truth. So obviously remember what the fear is. It's where you believe false things. So the antidote to that is what kind of truth? Yes. So God's truth is going to become more and more important to you here. God's truth is the thing you're sort of focused on. You're not interested in listening anymore to what that person thinks about it, what this person thinks about it, and what this person wants to justify the fact that you've got that problem. You know you've got the problem. It's causing an issue inside of you. You know that. It's hurting other people. You know that. God's truth is the thing I need. So now I'm pretty open. I'm longing for God's truth. Praying to God a lot now, where I'm longing but from my heart for him to show me what the truth is, even if I'm afraid. I'm still, because the key to dealing with this fear is letting myself feel the fear as an emotion, but also allowing myself to feel what God's truth is about it. Now, I've found that quite difficult with some issues regarding self in terms of worth. Most of us want to believe the world's worth, definitions of worth. And it's a pretty big issue, the issue of worth on the planet. So you're going to have some struggles there. And if you have issues of superiority inside of you that are linked to pain, then obviously you're going to find acceptance of God's truth quite hard at times. It's about being humble to that. Right? Okay, is there any questions about that, or are you pretty much right there? And then the last thing I wanted to talk about was this, what we, and it's really about handling fear still, but we just want to just make a note about this, the way in which we handle physical ailments in our body. So what should we call it? Should we just call it medications or whatever? Now, we need to take medications when we're unwilling to actually experience things emotionally. So I'm not saying to you don't take your medication or anything like that. It's up to you what you do with your life. But the medication's purpose is to suppress the underlying causes and just focus on suppressing the pain itself. So you need to understand that. So what we want to really do instead is we want to find the cause and release it, and then we haven't got the problem at all and you won't need the medication anymore. Right? That's what you want to do. So there's been times when you feel tempted to go for the medication or go for the vitamins or go for what it is that you feel will supplement you. But in this place, if you're really humble, you go, hang on a sec, all this is doing is taking me away from how I'm really feeling, and it's not going to really help me in the long run. And unless my situation is very serious physically, there's no reason why I need to do that. Now, if my situation is very serious, that indicates that I'm way up here still and I'm nowhere near this process. So if I've got serious physical ailments, then I'm way up here. I need to do that first. And in fact, if you don't do that, it's highly likely you'll die without your medication. Does that make sense? Because your body will worsen as if you take yourself off the medication and there's no, and on top of that you refuse to address the addictions, you're basically asking for trouble there. Your life will definitely be shortened if you do that. Whereas down here, if you, in this area here, you go off your medications, it's like your body's relieved. Get rid of another toxin, you know. So there's much more relief in your body there. Kerry, you would like to ask?
So would most of the world's major ailments, like cancer and thing, be all in the facade? Yep.
Yep.
Thanks.
Yeah, you'll find that if you deal with that, the majority of your personal ailments will disappear. Right? It's really if you deal with that above. Because remember, your terror has a large effect on personal ailments as well and drives your facade, actually. Right, so a lot of your ailments will disappear. That's what's happened for myself. A lot of my ailments all disappeared, regular sicknesses all gone. You know, it's only specific things that I'm avoiding, that I'm aware I'm avoiding, that cause a problem for my body. Some of them chronically even, depending on my level of fear.
Yep.
Yep.
Thank you.
Yep. Sherry, over this side. I've still got one very important point to raise with you, so I'll just keep it.
So, what does it mean if you, say, change your diet and then you get quite a lot better?
Well, a lot of times changing your diet is about doing something that is now more harmonious with love of self, right? So usually when people change their diet and get better, it's because now they've chosen a diet that's more harmonious with loving yourself. So of course that's going to have an immediate but not a long-term effect on your body. And this is why people might feel an immediate effect and then after a few years they don't notice that effect anymore, and in fact their body starts degrading again. In fact, this is what happens to many people who go on vegan diets. They initially feel better for a short period of time, and then the different emotional holes that they have that prevent them from actually addressing things are still there, and those are still not being engaged, and they start losing weight and looking drawn and feeling terrible, and then they feel like they've got to go to the doctor and he says, look, your iron's deficient and this is deficient and that's deficient and this is deficient, all because of the addictions and everything that we're not addressing and the pains we're not releasing. And as a result of that, we get sicker and sicker until we, usually what we do there is we decide to go back on a diet that we had before.
Yeah.
Right? Which is actually not the course of action we need to take from God's perspective. What we need to do is address the causes, which are all emotional.
Yeah.
And most of us refuse to address the causes emotionally.
Mm-hmm.
So we go back to the diet to try and prevent the issue.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep. All right, well, let's go on to the last but most important point of this process. And that is how God can be involved in it. Firstly, God is always, God's economy personified. God is always trying to show you the very next thing that is going to have the biggest and largest benefit once you release it. So God's always trying to do that. And what starts happening for you in this place is because you've now starting to develop trust and faith in God, you're now asking for God to do that. So now your desire is engaged to identify your biggest issues. So God's bringing, the law of attraction still working, but God's now got helpers, like so usually celestial helpers, but sometimes not. There'll be people on the divine love path in any sphere who understand your problem, who are trying to help you understand your problem. Does that make sense? And God's got that happening now because you've engaged the process of wanting God to assist you. In addition, there's a few laws of God that you can start engaging, which we'll have to talk about in our next group. And those laws include the laws associated with the redemption of humankind. So the laws associated with redemption are the law of compensation, the laws associated with repentance, and the laws associated with forgiveness. Now, we need to speak more of those laws later, obviously, and we will do so. But just briefly, you can see that these laws are going to help you identify pain and release it, and release the cause of it, which is the sin that triggered it. And the laws of repentance and forgiveness are unique in that they... So the law of compensation is usually done without our cooperation. So that's the law when we're not cooperating. And these laws are the laws that we engage when we are cooperating with God. Does that make sense? So you have the choice to not cooperate with God or to cooperate with God. It's a will-based decision that you'll need to make. Remember, all will-based decisions come from the emotional part of your soul, from your heart. So you can think you're engaging repentance when really you're not, and you're still just not cooperating. When you're not cooperating, the law of compensation will operate upon your soul. In other words, there'll be a penalty associated with whatever was done wrong that you'll need to pay for. Now, God does not, even when we repent and forgive, and in repentance and forgiveness, God will forgive us for our sin when we repent, when it's done truthfully and honestly with our heart. But not all of the effects of our sin can be actually fixed. And the reason why that is it requires the will of others for all of the effects of our sin to be fixed. Now, to give you an example of that, there's two examples I'd like to give. One is if a parent with a child who's now an adult. So the parent might go through the process of repentance for what they did to that child, but now the injury is in the child. And the child will not feel the full effects of that repentance on the parent's part until the child chooses to forgive the parent. Does that make sense? So it's going to require an operation on part of the child as well to benefit from what the parent has done. Another example is like my friend Luther in the spirit world. He created through his choices on earth, he created a religion, basically, a following based on false teachings. Once he passed in the spirit world, he realized that he had these false teachings. And he corrected them, and in the process became at one with God through his process of forgiveness and repentance and longing for God's love. He became at one with God. But the effects of his teachings are still going on today. The whole Lutheran faith still exists today, right? And that hasn't been taken away by God. God's laws are attempting to destroy the faith from this point of view of it when it's out of harmony with love. But at the end of the day, the faith will continue. And Luther is doing everything he can to correct the problems with the faith as well. And that will continue until such a time as the last person who is affected by Luther's sin, if you call it that, which it really is, has been cleared of that process. Does that make sense? So this is our trouble with sin, is that we become aware that we're very reliant on God to actually clear away the full effects of our sin, because we can't do it ourselves. There's some sins that we engage, particularly when we teach falsehood. There's some sins that we engage that have an everlasting effect on people, or a long period of time effect on people, and they need to be corrected, of course. You know, and that's going to involve the use of their will. So God can't correct everything without the cooperation of our will. If we all cooperated with our will, then God could correct it a whole lot. All right? But we don't. We don't cooperate with our will, so God can't correct it. So a false belief, particularly false beliefs on the planet that are taught by groups of people or individuals, you know, they are quite difficult to compensate for, as you can imagine. Repentance is the best course of action there. Once you've repented, you've cleared away your motivations for your sin, your causes. But the actual effects of the sin can often be felt for centuries afterwards. And in the case of some religions, like the Catholic faith, for millennia, you know, like thousands of years afterwards. The decision of a few men, thousands of years still being affected on the planet. And it's the case with most religious faiths, actually. Make sense? Savannah?
Thank you. With you talking about parents and their children, and the parents sinning towards the children, are you also talking about... like for myself, I'm not actually a parent, but I'm around Justin's boys a lot, so my sin's affecting them.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
Any person who's responsible for a child, whether they be the parent of the child or, you know, a child, whether they're orphanage or teaching at school, or, you know, like a school teacher has quite a large effect on children.
Yeah.
And therefore has usually, because they're in a teaching role as well. And unfortunately, nowadays, they're taught to really dominate and control children and dominate and control their will in order to get a result. And that's obviously damaging the soul condition of teachers quite a lot.
Yep. All right. Thank you.
Yep. So now we're in this stage where we're longing for God's love, and we have a sincere feeling of wanting to do that. And because we have sincerity in our heart, and we're willing to feel any pain that might come up, you know, that gets triggered through the process, we can actually long for God's love and receive it quite easily now. Whereas up here, it's very hard to have a sincere longing for God's love. Most of our sincere longings up here are just to get our addictions met. Does that make sense? But once we've deconstructed that and we've felt that, most of our sincere, there's a lot more sincerity in us then. And it's interesting, when a person does go through that, you can feel their sincerity. Like, it's so much different than what it was before. And of course, God feels the sincerity, and that's what God responds to. So that's when you start feeling more of God's love rather than less. And the only time you don't generally is when you've got a fear that's kicked in and you're resistive, and you'll know it. You'll feel yourself not receiving God's love under those circumstances. Instead, you fear there, and then once you release the fear and you let go of the emotion and you long for God's love, you feel that again. And it's like a cycle that eventually you get to the point when you've released all this pain, you now have really begun to live. And if you've longed for God's love through the process, it's highly likely you will also be at that time at one with God. Does that make sense? But that, of course, requires the connection to your real self. And that's why we've got to have the next 2 days of conversation with you about what the real self is, identifying real self, learning about the real self, and those kind of things. Does that make sense? So here we are, we're in this place now where we've got a connection with God, and now we're basically, at that point, you're in the eighth sphere of the spirit world, whether you're here on earth or not, and the reality from that point is now every bit of learning you engage has no pain associated with it. What a wonderful thing, hey? Whereas before, some of our learning, we made mistakes, you know, and fall over and, get up and so forth. And we're learning after that. It's just a joy, like joy after joy after joy. And it's just, how fast can I absorb everything? And how much do I want to absorb everything is what drives our desire to know more after that. Does that make sense? Johnny, you'd like to ask?
Yeah, hi.
If you stand up, Johnny. Thanks. Yeah. Thank you, mate.
I think it's a spirit that wants to ask this question, if it's all right.
Yeah.
It's about the repentance that you mentioned. So if you're aware that you have sinned towards someone else, should you like spend your life trying to make up for that?
What happens is, once you repent with God, you will feel God take away the cause of why you did it. In other words, you no longer have a feeling of wanting to do it, but also God takes away the guilt associated with having done it. Now, in that place, after you no longer feel guilty, then your actions towards others won't be driven by guilt. So a person who's constantly trying to fix what they've done without feeling repentance feels driven by their guilt. But a person who's actually repented for what they've done no longer feels driven by their guilt to correct what happened. Does it make sense to you?
Yeah.
One is a guilt-driven action, which is what we see majority of people on earth doing. And when they go into a state of repentance, because they don't feel all of their emotions about what they've done, and they don't feel God's forgiveness, because God's forgiveness can come once we feel repentant with God. God's forgiveness comes, and we're part of that forgiveness is asking God to help with the mitigation of all the effects of it, because we know we can't do that. We can't fix everything. And that's one of the things that you realize once you've forgiven by God, that the extent of your sin is that you couldn't even do no matter what you do, you can't fix everything, right? And if I can give a few examples of that, for example, I've decided to get drunk and I drive my car, right? And I run into another car and it's head on and everyone in the car dies and I'm still alive. Right? Now, under those circumstances, I have taken an action which has actually harmed a lot of people and taken away their life. No matter how much I repent for what I've done, part of the repentance process will need to be understanding the fact that I'm never going to be able to get back their life. There's nothing I can do to get back their life. Is that not true? Their life is gone. They're now in the spirit world. They cannot be on earth anymore. There's nothing I can do to fix that, right? And once you work your way through your full repentance and what you did and why you did it, see, that's what God's more interested in, helping you with why you did it, and you repent with God and you come to the stage where God clears away through the forgiveness process the actual causes, why you chose to, you know, in the case of the drunk man, why he decided to get drunk in the first place and why in a state of drunkenness he decided he could drive, all has to be addressed by the man. Once that happens and God's forgiven the person and they feel the forgiveness from God that enters their heart, they will not be driven by guilt to fix every drunk person on the road. They will only do what is in harmony with God's law. So in other words, they'll only help drunk people who want to be helped. They won't try and force, you know, laws that cause every drunk person to be removed or whatever. And the reason why that is the case is because they'll only do what is engaged in harmony with God's laws after that point. So guilt-driven actions are not the same as repentance. That makes sense?
Yeah.
And feeling the need to continually fix something forever is driven by guilt, not by repentance. So that means we've not yet repented. We've not yet felt the emotions associated with repentance if we do that.
Okay.
Yeah?
So when you really have repentance, you might feel, you know, that you want to do, you know, make up for it, but you won't spend the rest of your life doing it.
Well, you would want to do it. You'd want to make up for it, just like Luther has with the Lutheran religion.
Yeah.
But he doesn't do it in disharmony with any of God's laws. And also, he's not driven by his own, like, he doesn't drive himself mad doing it. Does that make sense? Or drive himself by guilt doing it. He does it because he knows it's the right thing to do and that's what he wants to do, which is very, very different than feeling driven by an emotion that you're not feeling, like guilt. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But if I repent for something,
yep.
Like I've seen against a lot of people, and will I want to search up all those people whenever truly repentance for that?
It's probably not going to be possible, Johnny, to search for all of those people and tell them that you're sorry. But even if you do tell them you're sorry, for many of them, they won't forgive you. And does that mean that while they don't forgive you, that you'll never be happy? See, the reality is, from God's perspective, once God forgives you, you can be happy whether other people forgive you or not. And after a while, you realize that other people forgiving you is an operation of their will. You can't demand it. You can't expect it. It's only something that they will need to engage through part of their own process. Make sense?
Yeah.
But we'll talk a lot more about these laws later in the law discussion that we have. But what I wanted to suggest to you now is that God now is starting to have a stronger effect in your life at this point. So once you start into this area here, God's now having a much stronger effect in your life. Up here, God's still intensely interested in your life. It's just you can't feel the effects because you're in so much addiction. You even want God to meet your addictions in this place up here, right? But down here, you don't want God to meet your addictions. You don't want God to take away responsibilities. You deal with things when you're dealing with them. But you do also feel at the same time, because you do it the right way, God's way, a higher flow of God's love as a result. Yeah. Okay, well, that's given you a bit of a summary of releasing the pain. Of course, we've not discussed the tools and so forth, but we've discussed them many times before. I'm already 17 minutes over, sorry for that. So not only am I 17 minutes over, add the 3 from the beginning and that makes me 20 minutes over. So I'll just cut down our Q&A about that. But you can see that the state you're in here is very, very different to the state you're in here, isn't it? And so you can start to identify and measure where you are by your feelings in this regard. And we'll talk more about that when I give you some group feedback about that particular subject. All right, so let's have our 10-minute break. If you come back by 12:30, thanks, and we can get started.